Hey everybody, today is our interview with Dr. Gillian Kenny of Trinity College in Dublin, who is going to talk to us about the position of women in medieval Ireland as part of our ongoing epic-length series on the medieval Irish Geis. And if you're listening to this as a podcast, you can also see it as a webcast on YouTube, where in the video portion, I draw Gillian's portrait right before your very eyes. She asked to be drawn as a specky Queen Mev from the Irish epic The Toinbo Quolney. Specky meaning with spectacles, I guess. You can see that on our brand new Dead Ideas channel at youtube.com. All right, let's get to the interview. Thanks for listening, everybody. The music we just heard was composed by Rachel Westhoff, my lovely wife, whose honor price is set at 3 MacBooks and a Roland synthesizer. I'm B.T. Newberg, but you can call me Brandon. We are continuing our monster-length epic series on the medieval Irish Geis, a kind of soul-binding personal rule or jinx of doom that spells your imminent destruction if you fail to obey it. For example, it was geis for Cathulain to eat dog meat, or for King Conaira to walk clockwise around his capital. And if you violate a geis, the power of fate basically rains hell and fury down on you, usually resulting ultimately in your death. See our previous episodes for a whole lot of fun about that. Today, we are going deeper still into the medieval Irish culture that spawned this dead idea, with particular focus on women this time. We touched on the topic of women in parts 1 and 2, and Andre summarized the situation as medieval Ireland was the most sexist of all medieval cultures other than all the other medieval cultures. And you saw some of the ways that gender gets portrayed in, shall we say, an interesting manner in stories like Jarmage and Gania, which Andre told in part 3, and Cathulain's adventures with the warrior woman Scathach and her rival Aoife, which I told in part 4. But enough of our amateur blabbering on. You expect more from us, which is why we are finally going to the experts. We have got not just anyone to hang out with us today, but Gillian Kenny, who specializes in women, family, sex, and magic in medieval Ireland. Thanks for being on the show, Gillian.
You're very welcome, Brandon. Thanks very much for having me. I'm delighted to be your first interview. I'm breaking your virginity, obviously. I'm delighted to take your interview, Cherry. Brilliant. Yes.
I will gladly give it up. I'm hoping my wife will give me a hall pass for that one.
Yeah, fine. Don't worry about it. You can be my secondary husband or something. There's an early Irish law precept for it. Yeah, I wouldn't worry.
Legally, we might have to invoke prima nocte or something there.
I wouldn't worry about it. I'll clear it with her. It's okay. Fine.
Now, folks, this is not going to be a typical interview, as you can already tell. It's more like just hanging out over a pint. So you have to kind of imagine us being at like an Irish pub or something here with some hustle and bustle going on about us and maybe somebody playing snooker or something in the background. Anything we should add to that image, Gillian, of the Irish pub?
Old men, a lot of old men sitting at the bar and just kind of staring into their pints. A lot of that. Yeah.
All right.
And unnecessary music, quite a bit of unnecessary music. Okay. So that would be an Irish pub.
Too much music, okay.
Too much music, yeah. You can't talk, that's the thing. You have to stay quiet, so there's quite a lot of that.
So we're just hanging out here, but I do want to keep one aspect of the formal interview genre, which is telling you just how effing awesome Gillian is.
Blimey, really? Wow. Yeah. I'll send you the check later. Blimey.
So Gillian Kenny teaches at Trinity College in Dublin in the Center for Gender and Women's Studies, and also got appointments at the University of Limerick and University College Dublin. And to go along with that, she's currently wearing a t-shirt that says, what does it say?
It says the future is female.
Excellent.
Then the past is also quite female as well, so, you know, is that.
Usually about 50%, yeah.
Yes, usually, and sometimes more.
Yeah. Her work focuses in particular on cultural exchange through intermarriage, because you see, in the period right after the one that we've been talking about in this series, the Normans started coming over from England and screwing things up royally. So what happens when that collision of cultures comes into the bedroom. You can find that out, among other things, in her book, Anglo-Irish and Gaelic Women in Ireland, circa 1170 to 1540. Anything else I should add, Gillian?
No, this is fantastic. Thank you. I will do bar mitzvahs and weddings as well. Blimey. Nice.
Well, the last thing I'll add is that Gillian has been a real treat to interact with, even just digitally over email and Twitter. And I'll give you a taste. Just this morning, she posted on her Twitter feed, favorite early Irish law term of the day, why the one that refers to a man who follows his wife's arse over a border.
I'm proud of my people.
So what is that term, Gillian?
Well, it's about, it actually relates to men whose honor prices are set at their wife's honor price. So if you follow your wife's arse over a border, it means you marry a foreigner. It's just a very poetic way of saying it. So in a sense, you're dead to your kin in that way. So, you know, we're fiercely regional people. So, yeah, I mean, it's just a nice way of saying someone who's essentially left the village and gone away. So he can sort himself out with his missus.
Oh, and what is the actual word?
I don't know, because I've read it in translation. I'd have to look up the old Irish for it. Yeah, I don't actually know the old Irish for it. Okay. It's a gap in my knowledge.
Okay, so listeners will actually have to write in to inform you.
Write in, yeah, and tell me what the old Irish for arse is, please.
Okay, sounds good. And we'll be talking about honor price in just a moment, too. Okay, so basically what I want to talk about today is what it was like for women in medieval Ireland to really get a feeling like we're there. And then after that, we're going to circle round to the idea of the geis and how women show up in these stories involving geisha.
The first thing that needs to be said is it's not a particularly sexist society at all. It's fairly standard early medieval gendered society. So essentially women do everything within the home, and men are responsible for stuff outside of the home.
From our perspective, that still sounds pretty sexist. Yeah, but for the times.
In terms of its context, it's pretty much standard. What does make it a little bit unusual is the fact that women had free access to things like divorce.
Okay.
So it's quite similar to, say, Viking women in some respects, and women could enter into contracts and things like that, independently of their husbands, certain types of women. So that is quite unusual at a time in Europe when, thanks mainly to the influence of the church, women's rights are becoming more and more circumscribed. But, you know, there's also, it's not by any means a kind of a matriarchy in early medieval Ireland. Women are heavily circumscribed, generally, legally speaking. But if they are women of a particular status, at a particular level of wealth, then there are ways and means for them to exert some kind of autonomy. So, again, like most eras in history, you have more freedom the more economically free you are, especially as a woman. So it rings as true for Ireland as it does for other areas, you know. But in terms of what they did, if you look in the early Irish law codes, there are references to, of course, there's women stayed in the home generally and they were expected to marry and bring up children. But for example, there are women who also worked. We do have evidence of female poets, who were especially dreaded because in the early Irish society, well, words have power. Mm-hmm. So you can curse people. And it was believed that it actually had physical effects. And female poets were quite ostracized. There are female healers.
Would that have been one of the satire poets then?
Yeah, satirists were particularly dreaded. So that's why in this period in Irish history, at feasts and so on, poets had the seat of power beside the chieftain because you didn't want to piss them off, basically, because they could... magically kill you through the words of the power of their words. Yeah. Women who could do that were especially dreaded because, women were associated with magic and often with black magic. So they were particularly dreaded because you get women doing it, not many, a variety of things. A very noted female occupation was to be an embroideress. Okay. Embroidery was incredibly important. how people looked, what you spent on your embroidery, how you sort of decorated yourself was extremely important and an indicator of status. So that's, say, female embroideresses, for example, had a slightly higher honor price than most other women. So it's, you know, it's a very rural society. It's quite fragmented. There's no towns really. There are proto towns around the monasteries. There are towns set up by the Vikings, but it's really quite rural and very heavily organized around kin. So yeah, you know, it's not like it's all about. It's a warrior society. Women somehow slot into it. And it's all about raiding, cattle raiding, and that's the currency of the time as well. So, you know, it's that kind of a society.
Okay, so it wasn't by any means equal opportunity. It wasn't like a female paradise. But
no,
it wasn't the worst thing ever either.
No, it's not. I mean, if you look at the legal codes, I mean, what people always find hilarious is the fact that there are there are various reasons why you can divorce your husband. Mm-hmm. You know, because marriage in medieval Ireland is a civil contract. It's not religious. It didn't take place in a church. It was simply a betrothal ceremony with the families, and that was it. Mm-hmm. And if you could divorce your husband if he was too fat for sex, you could, which is like brilliant. I mean, you know, what? That's the best period in history ever.
I think I read also you could divorce him if he couldn't get it up.
Yes, he could. Yeah, if he was impotent, if he was gay, which, you know, makes sense. Uh-huh. If he spoke about your sex life, you could divorce him.
So if he gossiped behind your back. Locker room talk was outlawed.
Yeah, absolutely. Trump would be in such trouble. Oh, God. Trump would literally be stoned to death. So not really. He would be in such trouble. He would be heavily fined in medieval Ireland for that kind of talk.
I can't imagine how much honor price he would have to pay out to people.
I think he would be fairly bankrupt at this stage. You know, he would have people fasting against him outside Trump Tower to try and get their money out of him. Might be a good idea, actually. America, fast against Trump. Do it.
It's starting here. We're starting a movement.
Come on, America. Sit outside Trump Tower and don't eat until he does what you want him to do.
Yeah. Failing that, do a satire spell on him over social media.
Possibly could be arranged. I mean, I know people who do it. I don't know. What else can you do? I want him to turn orange. Done. Yeah.
Okay, so let's go with the honor price thing here. And if anybody's wondering, we should have said this at the start, but if anybody's wondering what honor price is, go back to our previous episodes. But the basic thing is everybody in society, based on your rank and station, has a set legal honor price, and you can collect that, or your kin can, if you're killed, injured, insulted, etc. It determines your the size of the contracts that you can enter into, and a whole bunch of other economic things.
Yeah. But it did vary, as all things can, on the status of the people involved. So yeah, it is quite complex, really.
So is it true that a woman's honor price was legally set at precisely 50% of that of a male peer?
Well, there are variations. The thing is, in the Irish law codes, there's no one particular code that you use for the entire island. So there are variations.
Okay.
And honor codes varied depending on the status of the woman. And if I give you, set it in context for you, there are approximately 9 different types of marriage in the Irish law codes. And one of them involves the marriage of a higher status woman to a lower status man. Mm. And that affects honor price as well. Mm-hmm. And honor price is also affected by things like, as I mentioned, if he follows the arse of his wife, or if he marries a foreigner, if he marries an heiress, his honor price is matched to hers. So it doesn't always hold true. It's not. Okay. It's not always a given. It's. Our medieval Ireland is unusual because it does have a law code or law codes which are pretty standard, but they are always accompanied by glosses and commentaries which change depending on the lawgiver and the area it's given in. So it's quite subtle.
So if you were a lower status woman and married a higher status husband, your honor price raised or his lowered?
No, it would be approximately half of his. Yeah. If you were lower class marrying up, it can change if the male female is unbalanced the other way. Okay. That's when it can change, usually.
Okay. Okay.
So, but yeah, I mean, it's not particularly a comment on sort of the way women were viewed. Women were viewed legally as akin to children, and children's honor prizes are not full adults as well.
Correct.
You know, so they're viewed, and like in many law systems of the time, they weren't viewed as having any particular agency, because your honor prize is to do with, of course, legal systems. So women could not give testimony in court.
Oh.
You know, things like that. So that's why generally they have a lower honor price. They have less value to the community in general. That's just the way it was kind of viewed at the time. And I mean, the very interesting thing, of course, is that some of the Irish laws may go back quite a good amount. I mean, it used to be thought that they were sort of set in stone and fossilized from the Iron Age. That's probably not how it was. There's certainly heavy early Christian influence on a lot of them. But certainly some of them are pre-Christian. Some of them are older, but probably the ones about women have been heavily influenced by the monastic scribes who wrote them down and altered them. So, you know, you do have the influence of that.
Okay. One other thing about this that I want to ask you, because I found a reference to this in Rhys Patterson's book. She said that if the woman could provide for fuva and ruva, which is the military service owed to your lord, you could, as the woman, get a higher honor price up to 100% of a male peer.
Yeah. Yeah, it's probably in relation to the Ban Gomarba, which is the female heir, who is a very unusual figure in Irish law. But yeah, I mean, it is possible that you could do it because the law is fluid on some of the points.
Okay.
So if you did have the capacity, it's not beyond bounds that your honor price could be hired up. Absolutely. Yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Very cool. Okay. Let's go to marriage now. I want to hear a little more about that. So, a married woman could actually keep her own property and it wouldn't necessarily become the property of the husband, correct?
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. Yeah. So, they would get married and he would pay the bride price, the quivka.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Quivka is how you say it?
Yeah.
Okay, quivka. Okay.
Yeah, it's C-O-I-B-C-H-E, but it's pronounced quivka.
I love I love Irish spelling.
Yeah, great. Completely random. So really. So he would pay the bride price and she'd bring property with her. Now, probably in reality, when people got married, the man would probably bring land to it and the woman would probably bring the majority of movables, which would mainly consist of cattle.
Okay, cattle, so movable wealth. Okay, yeah.
She had movable wealth. Mm-hmm. And then it's quite complex, but when that's pooled together at marriage, she still holds on to a portion of her movable wealth. So if they divorce and it's not her fault, the crucial thing is it's not her fault, she will get about a third of hers back. Now, bearing in mind that it should have multiplied and increased in value since she came into the marriage. Mm-hmm. So she will get about a third of that back when she leaves. Well, the man, if it's not her fault, if it's her fault, it could be substantially reduced and she may not get anything.
What if it's the man's fault that they divorce? Does he not get some of his back?
No, it doesn't work that way.
Okay, yeah, I expected as much.
Go. Unsurprisingly, yes. So, yeah, because of course this is the whole idea of women being responsible for the generation of heirs and, you know, they could be trusted and blah, blah, blah. So they needed to be spotless in how they... But it's an interesting part of Irish medieval history as well, because you could divorce your husband and he could divorce you if you were both if you were infertile. There's also a provision where you can leave your husband for a year, have sex with another man, have a baby by him, and then bring that baby back to your original husband. So you're actually allowed to do that.
Wow!
You know? Yeah, that's really interesting. You can have like. You can go, you can't give me a baby. So I'm going to go here and have a baby and then I'll be back.
Huh. Well, that's really cool because that's probably the closest thing to polygamy that in the other direction, where the wife can have multiple male partners.
Yeah. Yeah.
But
I mean, the barrier to it, of course, is the fact that, the laws as we get them have been heavily Christianized and therefore they are completely on the side of sort of, you know, chaste marriage. no idea what happened in the past before this period in Ireland. But the casualness of the Irish attitude to premarital sex and the lack of illegitimacy in Irish law. Children are not illegitimate in Irish law if the parents are not married. There's no concept of it. Children are just children, and the father, if the father claims them, that's how that process begins of children becoming heirs. So the fact that that exists in Irish law is an interesting development, because it does kind of speak to the idea that sexual mores were somewhat more relaxed amongst the Irish than they were in other areas of Northwestern Europe at that period, you know. And you get it in the later period when the Anglo-Normans come over and they are bringing over Western European ideas about, you know, chaste marriage, coming directly from Rome and from church reforms in the 12th century and even earlier. The Irish, they love the fact, I mean, you get these Norman lords who come over and they will live a life that's based on English legal code in terms of property inheritance and the and crime, but their sexual lives and their social lives are Gaelic. So they will keep more than one wife. So they sort of get the best of both worlds, because they could have several wives. I don't know whether it would be a good idea to have several wives, though.
It sounds like a lot of work to me.
It would be completely exhausting, you know. And you know, I mean, if they all, I mean, we used to laugh at this probably, but you know, if as women do, if they live close to each other and they, you know, their cycles got in sync, can you imagine? Do you know what I mean?
It'd be like,
I'm leaving the country for about a week. I'll see you all then, because I just can't handle it, really.
Yeah.
So yeah, I think it sounds like a better idea than it is. But yeah, certainly there's loads of stuff in the law codes, in the English records about Norman lords, you know, having sex with Irish women, and it's not allowed, because of course it's, you know, it's seen as fornication by the later people. But it's interesting. It's not in the Irish kind of social system. Despite the heavy Christianization and the influence of the monks, the attitudes to sexuality are much freer, which is very interesting considering Irish attitudes recently, the last couple of hundred years, became incredibly prudish. So it went completely the other way. Obviously. Whereas in our past, it's a free-for-all, literally.
Okay, one thing I want to clarify with you is it was really interesting when you said that attitudes toward premarital sex were much more casual, because something that Andre said, and neither of us are experts by any means, so just, you know, feel free to just slap us up silly for this, but he described the situation being that basically if you had sex with a woman, that constituted getting married to her. So the idea of premarital sex is kind of like, it doesn't make sense the way he described it. Is that not accurate?
No, I think I know what he's referring to. It's one of the classes of marriage. There are 9 classes of marriage, and there is a type of marriage which is a casual marriage, which is basically a marriage that lasts a night. I mean, and again, it's the Christianizing influence. You bang someone. You wouldn't actually, you know, go, I'm marrying you. It's the act of sex constitutes the contract.
So that one is till dawn do us part.
Pretty much. and it's just, thank you very much. And then if children issue, that's another part
of it. That's a whole other issue.
It's like we're going with prostitutes and something. That's the way that's kind of rationalized. I mean, there's also in the non-Irish Western Christian tradition, there are, you know, clandestine marriages, which are very common, particularly from the 12th century on, where people marry without the priest because you didn't need it according to church law at the time. And it was that it's a contract whereby the act of sex formalizes the marriage. So you will say, I will marry you. And then they have sex and the contract is made. And that's a formal contract in the Western Christian tradition, but it's not the same as the Irish one.
Okay.
The Irish one is the priests or the scribes who wrote the laws trying to tidy it up a bit and make it more respectable than it is. Yeah.
Okay. This also brings up a question that we came up with and couldn't answer in our episodes, which was we were discussing a female slave, which they did have some slaves in medieval Ireland.
They did. They had a lot of slaves.
Yep. And we were wondering, in that situation, did the owner have like unlimited rights to satisfy his male desires on his female slave, or was she protected in some sense by this idea that you kind of halfway got married if you, and then you were on the hook economically in some sense, if you had sex?
It's an interesting question, because there are, motifs about, like, the classic story is Nile of the Nine Hostages was born of a slave woman, you know, but made his way up to the kingship. The most likely thing, of course, is that sexual abuse was rampant amongst owners and female slaves. They're not particularly well protected slaves. They're almost non-humans in many ways. But what could happen is that if a sexual relationship between master and servant resulted in a child, the slave's position would change if the master claimed the child, which is a formal legal procedure. So he would say, "That is my son." And therefore the son, because there's no concept of illegitimacy, becomes part of the kin and becomes a contender for kingship eventually. And that changes the slave's position, because she becomes then the mother of a future king. Could happen. Yeah. But, it's a society where slavery is endemic. So it's not particularly, pleasant. I wouldn't imagine for the female slaves.
I don't imagine either. All right. The last thing I want to talk about before we move on to the concept of the geish, is badassery.
Oh yeah.
Among
okay.
women.
So
we heard in the story of Cathalan from the Toyn of the warrior women. One was Skahak and the other was Aoife. And I want to ask you, to what extent did this actually go on? I realize it's going to be rare, but were there actually women who performed military service?
No, not as such. It links back to, there are some women who became involved in warfare and politics. It links back to the idea that when a woman married, she kept control of her movables that she brought with her. Now, in some instances, the movables were armed men.
Okay.
So she actually had her own private army. So there are instances. They aren't rare. And women could get involved in political warfare in Ireland by swooping in with their men. Now, what normally seems to happen as well is that they tend to, when a woman married, she never became the sole responsibility of her husband. She maintained legal links with her own family, her father and her brothers, and they influenced things to a massive extent. So in the instances I've seen, the women generally intervene on behalf of their own family, their brothers and kin, not their husbands. In one instance, she went against her husband up in Donegal, just completely went against his wishes and brought her mercenaries in to fight on her father's side. But it is rare. It is rare for them to take to the field. What's more common is that they acted as negotiators. Women did do that. They did travel. And they did, at times of war, if hostages were taken, they were sent. They did it, in Gaelic Ireland, and they did it with the English.
Was there some sense of them being protected in some way? Like it would be dishonorable to just outright kill the female messenger sent as opposed to a male messenger sent, or?
There's many, many instances of women being killed, in the annals. Women weren't particularly, as with everything else, in medieval Ireland, you didn't want to kill the rich ones, the wealthier ones with status, because then you'd have to pay the honor price.
Right.
It didn't really matter if you killed lower down. They're not particularly, there's no kind of chivalric view of women in that sense. So they probably acted as negotiators because they were women of high status could do that. We're used to operating at a high level politically. So when the husbands were, you know, held for ransom, they would be sent to try and negotiate a way out. Also, it depended if their networks were such that they could appeal to both sides, then that could come in useful as well. And of course, there's this old idea of a woman acting as peacemaker. So it fits a certain narrative. And sometimes women slotted into that as well. So it's quite a very string of reasons as to why they could do it. But it did happen. Okay. It's not full of Xena warrior princesses, though. I get some very peculiar ideas floated at me from people who appear to have seen miniseries that are full of nonsense and talk about, but you know what? Women were tough. People were tough. They were just tough anyway because it was tough times to live.
Sure.
So they were, I think everyone was kind of a badass in medieval Ireland anyway, you know, just in general.
Yeah. Oh, that's awesome. Okay. All right. So now I want to make the transition where we circle around to talking about geish. So now we're going to talk about women and magic, women and geisha.
Okay.
Okay. So you told me earlier in our kind of back and forth and emails before this interview that the characterization of women in some of the hero tales is interesting. And we may have gotten some inkling of that with some of the stories that we've heard in previous episodes here. But tell us more, like, what did you mean by that? And what's your take on that?
Well, often the depiction of women in the hero tales is quite negative. Mm-hmm. When you talk about women who put a geis on a man, mm-hmm. for example, Dermid and Grainne, mm-hmm. It's seen as being done to fulfill the women's nefarious sexual desires, and it mm-hmm. brings the destruction of the man. Mm-hmm. Women who dabbled in magic, who issued a geis and things like that, were viewed with terror by the medieval Irish, in common with many societies, fed by mainly the teachings of the church, but also perhaps older traditions that were wary of magic. And the creatures that went alongside it, for example, this idea of the Tuatha De Danann, who turned into what are now the Sidhe in Irish fairy lore. So women were seen to have malicious intent with magic, and the depiction of women in these stories as powerful because they can put a geis on a man and make him do things is something that speaks from the, I think, the darkest elements of the Irish psyche, the fear of women who have become so powerful that they cause destruction. The classic example is Queen Maeve, who is depicted as she is a goddess, really. She is an archetype, but in the Táin, she is a woman who sells her daughter to men, sleeps with anyone who moves, and the final image of her is of her pissing in the dust after she's caused utter destruction, you know? So I think, it speaks to this idea. It's not a society that views powerful women with a certain equanimity. And mm-hmm. It has a deep-seated fear of very powerful women and what they can do to warriors. And so you see this in the tales. I think the tales are a reflection of it. And you see it in the laws. Plenty of early legal texts and religious texts condemn the practice of magic and associate it with women because there is a tremendous fear of the emasculating effect that powerful women who use magic, because a geis is a piece of magic, mm-hmm. you know, it's, yeah. you're imposing on a taboo is an interesting word to use, but a prohibition on someone, sure. or making them do something pretty much against their will. Mm-hmm. There's two sides to it. So yeah, it can be seen as incredibly emasculating in a society where to be a warrior and to be virile mm-hmm. and all of those things was the premium way a man had to be. So yeah, I think what you see is tremendous fear in the hero tales.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we definitely saw that in the story of Jarmage and Grainne, where Grainne was the one who wanted Jarmage to, you know, get with her, right?
Yeah.
And he didn't want to.
No.
But he was like, no, I have to be honorable and I have to obey my lord and we can't do this. But she's like, geish, now you have to.
Yeah, she's like, aha, snap my fingers and it was a result in your death. Yeah, there's loads of them, you know. The Cucullin one as well is a good one as well. And he kills his own son because of a geish he put on his son mm-hmm. as well. It always ends in tragedy, the real things, I mean, they existed. There's a mention in it's not mentioned often, there's a mention in the legal codes of the geis on the King of Tara is to be whole of body. That's the only geis on him. But if you look elsewhere, there's loads of them. There's loads of them about how you know, how they can travel in certain places, certain kings, only kind of clockwise, and how they can't leave certain areas after dark. And there's a whole raft of them about, I mean, it's to do with ritual kingship and the sacral nature of kingship, of course.
Right.
But I think the interposer, I mean, the use of women in these tales is often as well as a kind of a, you know, a sovereignty goddess. Mm-hmm. So she's there to sort of copper fasten the king's claim or to dismiss it because he made a bad judgment and things like that. So the geis is a magical device that's used to get rid of or kind of copper fasten or, you know, approve of certain kings. But yeah, I think it speaks to the fact that there's this really interesting sort of general idea that, you know, oh, Irish women are really feisty and, you know, they've always been this, that and the other, like Maureen O'Hara shouting at stuff in The Quiet Man. Mm-hmm. They've always been this way throughout history. And it's not that way at all. You know, it's entirely different. Powerful women have been viewed with a level of suspicion in common with many cultures, in fact.
Let's go to the thing you said about them kind of echoing a sovereignty goddess kind of thing, which goes back to pagan Irish mythology.
Yeah.
So when we think of a goddess today, I think it's the instinct is to analogize it to like the Judeo-Christian god, which we largely think of as well-intentioned, if nothing else. Benevolent, right? But in Irish mythology and most pre-Christian European mythologies, divinity was not necessarily all good or all benevolent. They might be the ones on your side, but it was more... Being a god or a goddess was more about having power and communicating with or interacting with that deity was dangerous because this is, you were contacting something that could help you or could completely F you up.
The Irish gods, like many gods, are capricious. Mm-hmm. And they are gods which, are not particularly, but there are benevolent gods. Of course there are. There's Dian Cecht is the god of healing, and the great god, the Dagda, is quite a benevolent god. But you've ones like the Morrigan, which in her three manifestations is basically war and death, you know. And she is the washer at the ford, and she is seen before battle, as in her old crone manifestation, washing the armor and the bloody guts of men who will die that day. That's actually, there's a 15th century instance of English soldiers seeing that, which is really bizarre. They claim to have seen an old woman washing blood and guts in a river on the way to an Irish battle, which is quite odd, which speaks of a cultural crossover. But the Irish gods are not particularly, they're not in that Judeo, well, the Judeo-Christian tradition, I mean, even still is quite a recent one. I mean, Yahweh is originally a god of storms, so he's not particularly pleasant, but he's been molded into this idea.
Exactly.
The Irish gods, even still today, because I know lots of pagans in the Irish tradition, and they would think twice before trying to contact somebody like the Morrigan in their kings. They're like, I don't think so. I think I'll leave her to one side. But you have people like Bridget, who's, you know, seen as quite, you know, harmonious and, you know, quite giving.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, they're based on a culture which lived in fear of yet also emulated strong characters. So the gods represent that, you know, it's a time of strong men who ruled. And you see that in the way the gods carry on, I think.
Mm-hmm. Oh, very cool. Very cool. Okay, before we go, because we're kind of getting close to time, but we've got a little bit of time left. There's something that I really want to ask you about. It relates to women and marriage. So we're kind of going back to that section right now. But this was in Nerisse Patterson's book, and I found it really fascinating. So we touched on the fact that polygamy was okay for men. You could have more than one female partner.
Yeah. Well, you could have a principal wife, and every wife after that was less than. So you've only got one main wife. The rest of them have to kind of get the, you know, what's left.
Yeah, and that's where I'm going with this.
Your main wife could beat them up for 3 days when you brought them into the house.
That's exactly what I was going to ask you about.
She's allowed to beat them up.
Yeah. So the way I read it was, okay, if you, as the main wife, the primary, do not consent to him bringing in this concubine, right? Yeah. Then in that case, you have basically legal immunity to do anything that you want to the concubine short of murder, whereas the concubine can only fight back with nail scratching, insults, and like that sort of thing.
She can only defend herself. She can't use anything on you. You can't mark her. You can't damage her so much she's marked.
Okay.
Give her a guiding. I mean, I'd imagine there'd be
Wait, the primary can't mark the concubine, or the other way around?
No, she can't mark the concubine. She can't damage her for life.
Okay.
But she can give her a good hiding.
Okay.
Over 3 days, and then that's it. Then they have to live together.
Yeah. So the clock is ticking.
Yeah, it's like, right, here, go. And she walks in, like, go. 3 days, check the sundial. When's the third day? And you give her a fair hiding.
Yeah.
I would imagine they fought back quite vociferously, though. You know, I don't imagine they would take it.
No.
They were allowed to give them a hiding. Although in the medieval world in general, men were allowed to hit their wives but not mark them. So it's quite a common idea. You're allowed to, you know, chastise, but not to mark, not to incapacitate mark forever. So yeah, it's quite common. Yeah, it's, I mean, unpleasant, but you know, it's the way it was. It's quite rough. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I like the 3 days thing. I think that would make a great reality show, although I hope it would never, ever happen.
The first wife never even slept. You know, she's got someone to prod her away because she can give the new one another punch.
Oh,
you've got 5 hours left. Right. Stand her up over there. Let's go. I'm sure people really suffered. I mean, I don't know whether it happened a lot, you know, because people have to live together. And it was...
Sure.
I mean, I don't think, to be honest, I mean, I really think that it was rare enough that people married more than one woman, because you'd have to have quite a pile of, like, money, you know.
I would say so,
I think it's actually quite rare. I mean, the ones that I've come across are chieftains, mm-hmm. you know, and they die, and then people are like, you know, he died, and he has, like, 56 sons, and you're reading that, and you're like, probably had more than one wife then, or... A very busy wife.
Yeah.
it would be people who are very high status.
Yeah.
You know, the interesting thing about early Ireland as well is that, you know, some marriages were of course entered into for political purposes. So you do have people who don't particularly like each other
mm-hmm.
who are married, and then he might meet someone else, and, you know, but they could get divorced.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not like you're not stuck in it for life, you know.
Right.
But then divorce doesn't always affect the women terribly well.
Mm-hmm.
She loses a lot of her legal kind of freedoms when she's not a wife. So mm-hmm. that she wanted to avoid that quite a lot. So, you know, it's not entirely, you know, cut and dried in that way.
Mm-hmm. Well, is there anything else, Gillian, that you'd like to add, whether it's about women, marriage, geisha, whatever?
I suppose I just hope people can listen and realize it's quite a complex, interesting, unusual society in the context of its day. People tend to get very kind of mazed when their view of the medieval world is slightly turned upside down a bit.
Mm-hmm.
So medieval Ireland can do that
mm-hmm.
A wee bit because of the fact that there's lots of sexual freedoms
mm-hmm.
and, you know, the idea and view of how the Irish are and were
mm-hmm.
is very different 1,000 years ago
mm-hmm.
to how the Irish view themselves, I think. So people mm-hmm. like me are constantly trying to overturn this idea of a quite prudish, church-run, very staunch Catholic society. We were nothing like that until quite recently. It's quite interesting. This Gaelic society was in full flow until about the 17th century. And after that, you start to see the kind of creeping totalitarianism towards sexuality and family life that we suffered under for quite a while. But I just hope people, you know, read up a bit on it and read the laws. It's proper bonkers stuff when you get into it. I mean, I just love it because it's every time I read stuff, I discover new stuff. So it's properly mad and will turn your view of the Irish upside down. Although I think a lot of people are quite comfortable in thinking we've always been very respectable and church going and stuff. Rubbish. We're not absolutely rowdy, bawdy, badly behaved, violent. Mongrels of Europe. That's what we are. But anyway.
And they can start with your book if they want to learn some stuff about that.
My book, yes, even though it's, you know, written for academia, so, you know, you might fall asleep after five pages, but you know, it's there's lots of really good stuff out there. As you mentioned, Neris Patterson is there. There's loads of really good people who are writing on it, so
sure,
delve in, people.
Gillian, do you have any projects that you're working on right now that you would like to share with us?
Why, yes, Brandon, I do. I am currently doing a bit of research on the history of sex toys. So sex toys. Yes, it is. Sex toys is my new thing. So I am, it's not all dildos either. There are many stories about mirrored rooms in Chinese emperor's rooms and penis rings and extenders, which is another good one. Quite early on in human civilization, men were trying to extend their penis. I know that's not particularly amazing. You know, I'd say that takes absolutely nobody by surprise. But it's quite interesting when they're doing it with bits of wood and bone.
Yeah. So, very fun.
Yeah, so that's stuff I'm looking into at the moment. Not just Irish stuff, you know. The Irish don't seem to have been too big on sex toys. Well, we haven't seemed to have found any. So too busy off there raiding and killing each other.
Maybe they just wore them out with use.
Hey, so. Yeah, that's what we did, because, you know, total studs, didn't need them. So I don't need them. I'm an Irish. I don't need a penis extender. I'm a maid. So I'd say they did. Right, I'd say they did. But yeah, that's what I'm doing. So I'll be hopefully doing some stuff on that in the near future.
Well, we did hear a little bit of that on our show, on our series on hysteria. We did see a little bit about sex toys in the part one of that. So
the doctors helping ladies by manually masturbating them.
Exactly.
Brilliant. Yes. Thanks so much, doctors. Yeah, what would we do without you? Yeah, mine goes further back, so it's quite a lot of medieval and some and early modern and right up. But a lot of the stuff has been done on modern sex toys. Not so much. Quite difficult to find a lot of information on them, unsurprisingly. But it is out there, believe it or not. People did do it. People in the past were dirty bastards. Same as today, basically. Yeah.
It's a human universal.
Well, you know what? There's nothing new under the sun, Brandon. I'll put it that way.
Okay, well, that's all the time we have. Gillian Canny, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thanks for having me.
And folks, if you like this and you want to learn more, like we said, check out her book, Anglo-Irish and Gaelic Women in Ireland, circa 1170 to 1540. Likely available at your local university library. We will be back next week with another interview. We're still not done with this epic length series. We're going to be talking to Finn Duar, the host of the Irish History Podcast, who's going to talk to us about the impact of the Vikings on Irish culture, which was big. So, in the meantime, check out his podcast. You can also find us at deadideas.net or on social media at deadideaspod or write to us at deadideaspod@gmail.com. All right, we'll see you next week. I'm BT Newberg, and this is Dead Ideas. Hey, thanks for listening, everybody. Remember, you can get your portrait drawn in the time period and culture of your choosing by supporting the show at www.patreon.com/deadideaspod. You can get lots of other great perks there, too, so check it out. All right, our epic series is ramping up toward its conclusion. Next week, we will talk to Finn Duar, and then have a brief interlude for a Valentine's Day episode, and finally, after that, we'll have our grand finale for the Geis series. It's going to be epic. More epic than anything we've done before. I'm keeping it a secret, but trust me, you do not want to miss it. All right, see you next week for our talk with Finn Duar. I'm BT Newberg, and this is Dead Ideas.